The caterpillar is a nice parallel to industrial civilization because it spends its entire life collecting natural resources and growing. And then it comes to enough. We're kind of fuzzy on enough as a society, but the caterpillar gets it. And when it gets to enough, it goes into its cocoon and it starts to transform. And when it's finished that process, it comes out and it's beautiful. And it lives very lightly. They sip the nectar of flowers. And their purpose is the well-being of the next generation. They lay the eggs that keep this thing going. The first cells of the caterpillar that become butterfly are actually attacked by the immune system of the caterpillar. Something's going on, it's not feeling very well, it's got to try to maintain integrity. The next stage is these imaginal cells come together and they form a core that's resistant to the immune system. At a certain point, the form of the butterfly in the caterpillar has gotten clear enough that all the rest of the caterpillar just turns fluid and flows into the substance to become the butterfly. We've been growing, we've got this huge amount of knowledge and resources available right now, and now we can transform that into a form that can serve the generations coming. Within a decade of society saying, understanding truly in their hearts, that we need to make this change, within a decade we no longer have to worry for our children.
The Pope in the encyclical, Laudato Si, said we have to dare to take the pain of the world and turn it into our own personal pain. And similarly, I think we need to take the pain of the world and take it on as personal responsibility.
But we can't wait forever. We can't wait, in fact, we can't wait a decade. We can't wait. We have no time. We've used up the time. We have to act as soon as possible, as soon as we can, and pull out all the stops.
A lot of people aren't exposed to what we're exposed to here in Northern Alberta. We're at the site of resource extraction, so we see it firsthand. But there's a disconnect between rural communities and urban centers where a lot of the information stays separate, you know, and not a lot of the information isn't communicated through our educational system.
Everybody here has health issues. We're not as happy as we used to be before industry came here. Maybe there's some way that somebody can, if we scream loud enough, then maybe people will listen.
For the children, for all the people who live in our community, for my own son who's on my chest here, and my daughter who's 19 years old, that we have to stand up and try to create a better future. We know that, you know, things aren't heading in the right direction as pertains to climate change and environmental justice. And so I think each and every one of us are responsible for making sure we do our part.
If we're setting these 2050 global emissions targets and you do the math, you realize it's people in their 20s and early 30s that operationally will have to meet those targets. The millennial generation has to be the ones to solve that.
And so, you know, certainly there will be some jobs that are lost. It's not about not changing, it's about how do we make sure that we continue to be a viable and strong and prosperous economy.
If you want to create the jobs, if you want to create the technologies, if you want to create the wealth, then you better lead. Because this clean disruption is inevitable. It's going to happen whether you want it or not. Don't resist. Lead this disruption. You either disrupt or you're disrupted. It's your choice.
Almost as far as the eye can see.
Yeah, so it's, you know, as a farmer to see, you know, land like this, it's not what you want to see. You want to see, you know, green, and you want to see it producing something that can then be taken and used for some other purpose. For years, our irrigation methods here had been to flood fields just using gravity irrigation methods just to put the water out across the field. Since probably about 2004 or 2005, we've been installing drip irrigation, and I'll show you guys that in a little bit. But the concept there is that you use electrical motors to pressurize the water so that the water goes through tubes under the ground and feeds the roots of the plants from below with the water and nutrients versus flooding the water on the top. You're looking at temperatures every day, so you're kind of calculating the evapotranspiration and the needs of the plant on a daily basis. And it also gives us the ability to put in fertilizer and things like that right into the root zone, which is a more efficient use of that as well. Your applied water overall is less, but the plant actually by itself consumes more water than it would in the flooded system, but your overall usage is down. But the plants are actually more productive. We have to pressurize with electrical pumps, so our electrical cost over the last few years has really gone through the roof. You know, the scary part is making a big investment. We're in the middle of a drought, obviously, so if we don't have water to put through the drip systems, the economics for the solar system makes no sense. So I think it's something that we have to do in order to survive. I mean, I'm still nervous about it, but we're just kind of trying to do the best that we can. The federal government tell us how much water you're going to get. 100% equals, you know, a certain amount. Mm-hmm. This year we're thinking maybe about 40%. No, we're trying to do our best. Like I said, you know, we know all of our resources are really precious, and we're trying to use, you know, all of them to the best that we can. You know, if we do things correctly, not only is it a good overall story, but it also helps our bottom line.
We've had 20 COPs, and what have we done to address climate change? Greenhouse gas levels are rising faster than ever. The extreme weather events are taking off. There's feedbacks putting more CO2 in. There's lots of groups around the world that have these very sophisticated computer models. First of all, you know, you run them backwards to see if they can replicate what's happened in the past. And then you run them forward and try to make projections as to what's going to happen. And these models are used a lot by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. But the models are under predicting the actual observed measurements of what is actually happening. For example, in Arctic sea ice decline, the latest models are showing that the sea ice may be gone the end of the melt season in 2040 or 2050. And if you look at the data, it's likely that there'll be no sea ice before the end of this decade. The Arctic has reflected about 52% of all the incoming solar light on average, and now it's down to 48. So this is a huge drop because it's over a large area. As we warm the Arctic, we're melting permafrost, and we're also getting release of methane from the permafrost on the land, but also on the seafloor. And methane is a very powerful greenhouse gas. So all of these things are happening with 0.8 degrees. So to tell me that we can take 2.5 times that warming, I don't know how that's possible. It doesn't make any logical sense to me. You know, that 2 degree limit is not really a scientifically derived number. Now, there are lots of people like James Hansen and other climatologists that are now saying 1.5 degrees is the highest limit we can go, but even 1.5 degrees is almost double what we have today. If that 2 degrees occurs over, you know, a long period of time, you know, 50 years, 100 years, then okay, but if it occurs over a decade or less, then it's a rate of change that is very, very important, which nobody talks about. So if we lose the sea ice this decade in September, then the extreme weather events are going to increase at least an order of magnitude 10, 20 times. Many parts of the world are undergoing extreme precipitation regimes, either droughts or flooding. You know, vast regions of the ocean are 4 or 5 degrees Celsius warmer than normal. It's causing lots of marine life kills off the west coast of North America.
Humans use the oceans in many different ways. Most importantly, we get a lot of food from the ocean, but we also use the ocean to transport our materials. A lot of the CO2 that we pump into the atmosphere gets trapped by the oceans. Much of the oxygen that we breathe comes from the oceans. And so if we want to maintain the lifestyle that we have and using the ocean the way we have, we must protect them.
The whole system seems to be reconfiguring. We're going into very unknown territory. You can only adapt so much. We have to go full speed ahead with mitigation. We have to slash fossil fuel emissions. Not by 2100, which the G7 just talked about, not by 2050. We have to treat the climate mayhem that is occurring as a global emergency that threatens our actual existence on this planet.
I don't know how much influence the Koch brothers have over decisions made in Ottawa. I don't know how much influence Imperial Oil and Exxon have. But what we're dealing with right now is governmental decisions that are taken in an irresponsible and reckless fashion, ignoring both the economic interests of Canada, the environmental interests of Canada, and the long-term ethical and moral obligation we have to ensure that we don't shoot past 2 degrees Celsius.
I think about all the water depletion all over the world, and it's a scary thing. But for us here, we're told not to drink our water from our tap. We always have water delivered to us every week, once a week. People don't even realize that. What I love most about this place is the people. I loved the river, but it's slowly being depleted. And I love the environment because it was so green at one time and beautiful, but it's not as great as it used to be. For me and for my grandkids to go to school in Fort McMurray, they get so used to seeing it, it's just like second nature, I guess. You know, to see all the tailings, sand that's blowing, the industry, the big stacks, and they're just so used to it now. It's not even really an issue anymore. I am sure that the government is aware of it. What are they going to do for us? Move us? Maybe that'd be the next thing they're going to have to do, is to move us from here. My sister will never leave here. She'll die here. Like, this is our home.
About 3 years ago, when the SWN started coming around doing the seismic testing, that's when everything started, really, and the non-native communities started coming and supporting us, and it just grew bigger and bigger. And
I was paying close attention through social media and what was going on up here with seismic testing, and there was a call out for some support and supplies over on the 116. So I talked to some friends and had some supplies rounded up and packed up a tent and sleeping bag and came up to the 116. My purpose really was to support, you know? And I didn't find an adequate representation of other races besides the Mi'kmaq people that were standing on the front lines. So I sat there in the driveway with them and I said, oh, I'm gonna stay here with you guys, you know? It's no longer an observation, you know, I'm here on the ground, which is.
We can't fight the government, you know, using violence. And, you know, sure enough, you know, RCMP, when they moved in, you know, they arrested, you know, started arresting people, you know, like, it didn't look good on them. We were standing there smoking our pipes or, you know, smudging or drumming, whatever, you know, doing our ceremonies and, you know, people were just picked out, you know, and getting arrested. We are a nation, you know, even though Canada don't want to accept, we are a nation.
The Grand Council stood firmly that we would support them to protect their lands and their water. So we invited several other different organizations plus local farmers and fishermen and so on to be part of this peace and friendship alliance group. So so we're making some noise and we're standing firm.
The moratorium was put in place by the province against the shale gas companies. It's not over, and it's not going to be over. There's so much money in that ground, and there's going to be another company that's going to come and want that gas out of there. So I'm not going to jump up, you know, and say hooray. I never will.
How can we forgive? How can we forgive these crimes? That's not part of the storyline of the Exxon Valdez oil spill. A lot of Native people killed themselves. The death water. So that was 25 years ago, and I still find myself in this position. You know, March 24th every year, it's become kind of a memorial for that oil spill. The death water was so intense, people were getting excited because in March, you start having the herring coming back. And so you got all this life, and the ocean's just teeming, and the coasts are just teeming, and you got the people that are the most reliant upon that faced with massive oil slick. Birds were just twisted up in it. Sea otters were just twisted up in it. The orcas are suffering today. The family will probably never recover. The hooligan have never returned. The shrimp have barely returned. How do I find forgiveness for the families that have been destroyed as a result of this crime that continues to this day? So what the elders have been telling me, it's all based out of love. Whether it's the love for oneself or love for the earth, that's why I'm here today.
For me, coming from this history of resistance, it's my responsibility to continue that. That my grandparents didn't, you know, die in vain, that they will be proud of me. Our communities had traditional governance systems and they functioned very well. You know, they had shared decision-making powers that were matriarchal. And I think a lot of times people have these ways of, you know, thinking that you can go into a community and somehow help a community when there also exists, you know, solutions in the community. The spill happened in April 29th of 2011, and the Canadian federal election happened, it was May 1st, and the community wasn't released the information until after the federal election, and so therefore we couldn't inform the media of how big the spill was until after the federal election. There was no emergency response plan for the community, so my family was left wondering if they should stay in the community, if pregnant women should be in the community, small children, you know. They couldn't breathe because of the noxious and volatile gases that were being emitted from the oil spill. The government was basically putting my family and the community at risk because they refused to admit that the problem was that big.
Sandy hit our community at low tide, and it's still 4.5 feet of water reach these shores. We're extremely vulnerable because there is no mitigation plans. And this is a place of mostly cement and asphalt, and it's not really a permeable surface for absorption of storm surge. And we want that to be one day.
When the floodwaters receded, there was a film on the ground. I emailed the Environmental Protection Agency several times and asked for testing to be done of those waters and whatever kind of contaminants would be in those waters. And I was blown off every single time. I've reached out to authorities that are supposed to oversee these issues, but that this community is systematically ignored when it comes to asking for testing to be done in what is a really concerning proximity to toxicity.
As human beings, we feel better when we're closer to water. So psychological effects, like some kind of light goes on when we're by it. I guess maybe because we're mostly water, right?
Our climate is very much modified by the Pacific Ocean, and we're seeing big changes in the Pacific Ocean that are affecting our weather, that are having big effects on our terrestrial ecosystems. This year we're seeing very warm waters off the Pacific that are resulting in a drought in British Columbia, in a lot of new heat records, and putting a lot of the forests that I study under considerable stress. It's also interesting, I think, to note that both the ocean and the forests contain huge stores of carbon, and temperatures directly affect how much carbon is stored, how much is sequestered, and how much is given off, depending on how healthy those systems are. So we're seeing big changes in our forests. And of course, disturbance is a natural part of all of these ecosystems. So coastal forests, the main disturbance agent would be windstorms. In more continental, more interior areas, we'd have more frequent fires that would be the main disturbance agents. So we expect to see the frequency and intensity of fires increasing. But what we also see is that warming, drying conditions leave trees more stressed and less able to fight off insects and diseases that impact them. So we see all kinds of mortality and injury in the forests increasing in frequency as the trees become stressed and as conditions become more favorable for the insects. And so that really impacted our forests, but it impacted communities that rely on those forests. It impacted people who work in the forest industry who rely on timber supply, and it left huge areas of forest in poor shape. But that also provided the canary in the coal mine in a lot of ways for British Columbia to take on serious climate action. We were the first jurisdiction in North America to have a carbon tax directly as a result of the mountain pine beetle epidemic. We've had agreements in BC that have set aside large areas for conservation. I think that the province of British Columbia has been a leader in thinking about how to adapt forest management to climate change, and they have a number of initiatives underway right now, but one of them is around climate-based seed transfer, so selecting what to plant based on what climates are expected in the next few decades. Foresters for hundreds of years have recognized that you need to match the trees you plant, not just the species, but the genetics of the trees that you plant to the local environment. We're in the process of breaking away from that old rule of thumb because local is no longer safest because the local place is no longer the historic local climate. There are actions we can take to modify forest management that will in turn have an impact on greenhouse gases. Now, do those substitute for mitigation? Absolutely not. We absolutely need action on climate right now from Canada at a global table, from all the other countries.
Here in the South Bronx, we are completely surrounded by highways, and this started with Robert Moses when he did the Cross Bronx Expressway directly through the Bronx, which borders us to the north. Then we have the Bruckner and the Major Deegan Expressways on the south. So the south and the north completely surround the South Bronx such that the community is completely surrounded by highway. Then where we're at right now is this waterfront. Here starts an 850-acre significant maritime industrial area. And that is the largest significant maritime industrial area in the entire city. So what happens is it becomes an issue of zoning. If companies have very large industrial projects that they want to site in a particular location in New York City, they're not allowed to do it in other areas because of zoning restrictions. And so what happens is that those companies are able to continuously site their unhealthy projects in the South Bronx in this particular area and in particular along the waterfront.
I think it's irresponsible to do that to a community, mostly a poor community of color. They have some of the highest asthma rates of obesity and diabetes in the city and in the country. To encircle its waterfront, which could be a quality of life enhancer by industrial facilities. And even as we stand here, and you can smell garbage because of a waste transfer station right behind it. Right just next to us is a train line that runs garbage upstate and then down to Virginia to a landfill, where we handle all the Bronx waste right here at this location and 25% of Manhattan. And I think it's an environmental injustice.
Trash, that's not something we think about often in our daily lives. But every year, Singaporeans generate 71.5 million tons of waste. The key to sustainability is to recycle.
With all these efforts, Singapore's overall recycling rate hit 60% in the past year.
I mean, fossil fuels in the purely economic terms, we're seeing it now from the International Energy Agency and other financial analysts, is basically a huge pile of stranded assets. Our former governor of the Bank of Canada, who's now the governor of the Bank of England, Mark Carney, talks about the carbon bubble. I mean, we have financial and economic experts saying, hang on, having fossil fuels that are unburnable is going to undermine your whole economy. You've got to shift off carbon as fast as possible, remove all the subsidies, and put proper pricing in place. So the economy of the future is without a doubt going to be a post-carbon economy.
it's right to say, in terms of energy use, you know, we have to figure out how we make that shift to a low carbon economy, using clean energy and being smarter about the energy we use in our buildings and becoming less reliant on more carbon intensive fossil fuels. But that takes time, that takes a transition. And so I think we need to have that very pragmatic conversation about how we make that transition. It's not going to happen overnight. And I think anybody who thinks it will happen overnight is being unrealistic. Typically, when you look at complex issues and complicated problems, they require a policy approach that is drawn from lots of different sources. You know, I think the challenge today is that you have to cut through all of that noise and that hyperbole on both sides, and you have to try and find ways of starting with where are the common interests, where are the points where we agree, and try to bring people together on those points and start the conversation there.
People do not need to be afraid of carbon pricing, because it can be done in a way that is not a tax grab, that is essentially just putting a price on behavior that is destroying the planet, which is emitting more carbon into the atmosphere. When you use a cap and trade system, you look at the outcome each year in terms of the carbon target, and then the price adjusts to meet that target. Whereas when you have a carbon tax, the price is fixed, and then basically you don't quite know how much emission reductions you get in every year. And so then you have to adjust the price over time to actually get to the level that matches your long-term target. If we are in a world where the emissions in a given year aren't all that important, but it's really a long-term phenomenon like greenhouse gases, then using a price mechanism is perfectly fine. Because even if you have variations in the annual emissions, maybe because of business cycle changes or the other things that are changing, it's still okay as long as we're on the right trajectory. When it comes to other types of emissions like sulfur dioxide, where we're more concerned about temporal clustering emissions in a given month, then of course a cap and trade is actually better, because it looks at the emissions over a much smaller time frame. There is one other key advantage of actually a carbon tax over a cap and trade system, and that is the dynamic incentive to innovate. When you have a stable price, then you're more likely to make a calculation for investing into new pollution abatement, because you have a much more predictable return on your investment. And that's the reason why carbon taxes are considered dynamically more efficient than a cap and trade system.
We're seeing sea level rise already, it's measurable. We're seeing a decrease in snowpack, we're seeing extreme heat, and we're going on our fourth year of drought. There's been a convergence of public support, and there's been a political leadership as well that has been built up. The governor at that time, Governor Schwarzenegger, signed AB 32, the Global Warming Solutions Act. And so what that did was set a target for reducing emissions to 1990 levels by 2020. So that was about a 15% reduction. Since then, our current governor, Governor Brown, has put out an executive order that would actually provide further reductions, 40% by 2030 and 80% by 2050. And it also, through a cap and trade program, it creates a cap on our most polluting industries, and that revenue for those that can't meet that cap, they buy allocations from others who can, and that revenue goes into funding programs. So we currently, through this fiscal year, have over $2.2 billion that will go directly into climate initiatives. We're bringing together over 1,200 people once a year that are some of the brightest minds and leading practitioners working on these issues. And I see the solutions they're coming up with, and I think there's hope. It's pretty amazing what's happening right now. And it's in the public sector with the progressive policies, but it's also in the private sector. And I think the sweet spot will be when we can leverage both of those and connect those.
The role of business is to win at the game, and the role of government is to set the rules for that game. I find it illogical when people come up with arguments saying, oh, this company has to cut their emissions and this company's got to do this thing and that thing. Companies exist legally for the purpose of returning money to their shareholders, and we should just get over the fact that they're going to do anything other than that.
Whether those businesses divest of their stranded assets or not, I don't think is so relevant. But I think it's more what you do with the money that you have, and that's where we come back to impact investing. If they just put it back into other corporations or other investments, which kind of seems like where they're headed, more like a negative screening type investment,
I'm not sure that that's really going to move any needles on anything. I think people are perhaps overplaying that this is going to have some major effect on the coal industry or something. I'm not sure the coal industry is going to be that bothered who divests of their shares.
So money is power, and using your money in a good way has a lot of good outcomes. You really reach into a bigger conversation than just investing for social good. It's really about people's values, about their beliefs, about their confidence in this world with what they have. It changes the conversation where it's not one about what's my financial return, what's my social return, but one of course, I believe in that and I want to put my money there.
Calvert Foundation is the epitome of an impact investing firm. So our business issues securities out to the world, particularly to retail investors. We allow people to invest in our business with as little as $20. And then we pool that money and we actively invest in businesses that provide both a financial return to us and a social return to society. So not one or the other, it's gotta be both things. And those are the companies that we then invest in. And then with the financial return that we get, we provide that money back to our investors again. So these aren't donations or grants or anything they're giving us, they're actually making investments like they would in any other company. One of the greatest forces that we face in this movement is the force of inertia. It's very difficult for people to do something different. There needed to be, and there still needs to be, a lot of discussion around how it's a financially profitable thing to do to make this move as well. Of all the potential retrofit opportunities in the city of New York, it's been like 1% of them have been done, but they're all profitable opportunities. And so it's a question of someone helping people understand that investing a little bit today, even though it's an investment and has to be paid back, that over the long run, the savings that you can get by reducing your reliance on expensive energy generated from fossil fuels, you know, is significantly profitable for you. The financial equation for people historically was much simpler, and it's become much more complex. And in the complexity is where all the things like the environment matter. So we can say costs now are not just the costs you have to write out of your checkbook, but there are externality costs. And the more analysis and the more studies and the more data that comes out on that, it helps with that cost equation, and that helps with the financial equation, which then helps people get over that inertia hump.
The increasing fragility of our planet has an increased impact on the poor in our society. They don't have the resources to defend themselves against man-made and then environmental outcomes. It all starts to intersect, and there's become, I think, a lot more greater understanding recently that we can't continue to do what we've been doing. We have to do things differently. And that's all been education up to now. I think what we're starting to see now is people wanting to actually change their practices. I think we're seeing people start to make different decisions when they consume, either not consuming as much or consuming in a way that's really thoughtful. And so we're kind of, I believe, coming out of this in theory talking about it to now starting to practice it. And that's good.
New technologies, especially technologies that improve on an exponential basis year after year after year, combine with new business models to essentially either destroy existing markets or radically transform them. When you apply the same methodology to energy and transportation, essentially you come up with the conclusion that the whole energy and transportation industry are going to be disrupted by essentially four technologies: solar energy, energy storage, electric vehicles, and self-driving cars. And what that's going to do is make oil obsolete, make nuclear obsolete, make natural gas obsolete, make biofuels obsolete, and that is the clean disruption. When you have self-generation, meaning solar rooftop generation, that's cheaper than the cost of transmission, the existing model of electricity generation and distribution doesn't have a prayer. Essentially, it's going to be about this green, not about being environmentally green. Now, Solar today is only 1% of the world's electricity generation. It will get to 10% and 100%. And to do that, essentially, it's going to need trillions of dollars. Cost of capital is the most important cost factor in clean energy. So solar today is 200 times cheaper than it was in 1970, 200 times. Oil today is 16 times more expensive. So when you combine those numbers on a relative basis, you get that solar today is 3,000 times cheaper than it was in 1970. Solar continues to go down. We expect it to go down another 50% or so over the next 4 years, which means that by 2019, 2020, on a relative basis again, solar will have come down by about 6,000 times relative to oil. Since the year 2000, solar has essentially doubled the market every 2 years. So today it's about 130 times bigger than it was in the year 2000. And if it keeps growing at this rate, basically doubling every 2 years, the question is how many more doublings do we need before solar is 100% of the world's energy? And the answer is 7. Are we gonna have enough material for solar panels to do this? Solar is essentially silicon. It's sand. Silicon is one of the most abundant elements in the world. To generate all the energy that every single house, every single airport, every single factory, every single business in the US uses every year, we need about 10,000 square miles of solar. The US oil and gas industry leases 150,000 square miles of land and water to pump oil and gas to produce about a third of our energy needs. Today, oil and gas is using 15 times the area that solar would use to power the whole United States. And I'll give you another data point that's pretty interesting. In the US, we have up to 13,000 square miles of parking. In the US, we travel about 3 trillion miles per year. So if all vehicle miles were electric and all of those miles were powered by solar, how many square miles of solar would we need? 1,000. If all we do is take 10% of our parking lots and we convert that to solar canopies, you could power every single electric vehicle in the United States for the whole year. As Tesla and other energy companies invest in lithium-ion batteries, it pushes down the cost of lithium-ion batteries. The cost of energy storage is going down so quickly that when you finance the purchase of energy storage, you'll be able to store one full day of electricity for about a dollar a day. This is happening despite governments, not because of governments. So the biggest barrier right now is, you know, what you would call regulatory capture. Essentially, when the regulatory bodies in the government end up regulating the public on behalf of the industries.
One of the worst policies in the world in terms of carbon management is fuel subsidies, where you actually subsidize the use of gasoline and other fuels. Many countries in the world are putting essentially a negative price on carbon, that is, they pay people to use more. Stepping away from these types of policies is very important. That's something developing countries can do, even now, and switching to other forms of subsidizing households.
It's impossible for the developed nations of the world to try to dictate to developing nations how they should develop, because England, Canada, United States, none of these countries thought about the environment as they were going through a development process, which lifted their entire population out of poverty, improved healthcare, improved education, improved quality of life. as we've seen in a lot of developing nations, there's a bit of an opportunity to almost leapfrog what's happened in the developed world. I think that you're starting to see in lots of places that the concept of a traditional energy system as defined in G20 countries might not make sense anymore. The idea of having these massive 1,000 megawatt electricity generation plants and then having massive grid infrastructure that needs to spread out across the entire country, and the whole concept of distributed generation and allowing for more renewable energy sources to have simultaneous production and consumption of energy. You're just starting to see that people can think about energy in an entirely new way. We might look back in 40 or 50 years and in North America, we will be the ones with the antiquated energy system, which is something that we would love to see.
I think it's so important to include the youth because we are going to live with it. We are having to deal with all the things that are coming upon us. And I think it's important also to give them all the access to information and all the access to possibilities, because the youth are the next generation of future leaders.
We're the first ones to feel the effects of climate change and the last ones to have a chance to do something about it. What are we willing to sacrifice? What are we willing to give to repair the problems that we caused that other people are dealing with?
I kind of embraced at some point quite young that I was going to be in this for a very long time. It might be a while and things might get really bad, but that doesn't mean I don't cling on to hope that something really good is going to come out of Paris. And I also know that regardless of what comes out of Paris, we're going to have a lot more work to do, and I'm ready, my friends are ready to keep doing that work.
Youth have a really optimistic viewpoint and a really creative viewpoint. We're naive enough to know that we can make a difference, but not yet jaded enough to know that that will be difficult. And I think the role of youth is really to be the innovators within any ecosystem. The way things have been done for 40, 50, 100 years is not the way they're going to be done for 40, 50, 100 years. And so that, in our opinion, is one of the things that we continually steer our youth towards, is how can they take their creative concepts, their creative ideas, and actually implement them in a world that's really complex and really set in its ways.
SunSaluter's technology is a solar panel rotating solution that helps to optimize existing solar panels so that they rotate to follow the sun at every single point during the day, and that actually allows you to generate up to 30% more electricity. Specifically, we hope to target off-grid rural areas of the world where they really need as much juice out of those solar panels as they can get. And so having 30% more electricity means that they can charge more cell phones, more lanterns, radios, stay connected with their families, and it has a really substantial impact on their lives.
I think the solar project is a good example of the solutions that we can find in communities. Like, I was kind of just sick of waiting on the government or industry to do the solar insulation for us. I just wanted to do it myself, with support of the community, obviously, but people understand the value of it, that we can create energy from the sun as opposed to digging into the earth. For young people to know there is hope out there. We don't have to just be stuck in fossil fuel dependent system. We can transition to a renewable system. And I really hope that it inspires the young people to look at working in the solar industry in the future, because I think if we have that in the community, it's proof that that's happening around the world.
When you use the lens of World War II, it becomes really easy to imagine how we could solve climate change. You just have to get into this mindset of like total mobilization. And isolationism, this incredibly powerful political force in the United States, just was gone. Everyone understood we are in danger, and that's the most important thing. Simply, it was everyone's responsibility to contribute to the war effort, and people did that in different ways. People joined the armed forces, 10% of Americans relocated to have a war job. The automobile factories were completely transitioned to airplanes and tanks. Every business, every family, every individual, every religious institution, every university said, our primary duty now is to help the war effort. Because without that, we have nothing. We don't continue. That mentality is precisely what we need for climate change. We need a rapid as possible transition off fossil fuels that absolutely requires every citizen, every university, every business. We're actors, we're agents in the world. You know, Margaret Mead said, never doubt that a small group of concerned citizens can change the world. Indeed, they are the only thing that does. It is about exposing, through action, the truth.
I think there'll be a tipping point in human behavior very soon, and people will actually go to full-out panic on what's happening and demand that rapid changes be done, treating it in an emergency fashion.
Any idea that was easy to implement has already been implemented. And if you've got a concept, you've got a business, you've got a nonprofit, you've got a social movement, you'll wake up and agree to get punched in the face every single day to make it happen.
Planet's getting angry, planet's getting mad, things are getting crazy, things are looking bad. There's a big storm coming, everybody knows, the planet's flooding. Nowhere to go. Planet's getting mad, things are getting crazy, things are looking bad. There's a big storm coming, everybody knows, the planet's flooding, nowhere to go. We got an angry planet, got a world of flame, temperature soaring, no one takes the blame. Oceans are rising now, we're all gonna pay, they said it come tomorrow.
Temperature soaring, and who's to blame?